In this video, we're going to talk about the blood vessels of the body, the vascular system. So let's talk about the blood vessels. If the heart is the body's pump, then the plumbing is the system of arteries, veins, and capillaries. Now, these terms are different names for different parts of our vascular system. Arteries are the blood vessels that always carry blood away from the heart. And veins always carry blood toward the heart. It's important to realize that the naming of the blood vessels doesn't really have to do with whether they are oxygenated or deoxygenated, but instead has to do with the direction in which the blood is flowing. Now, the capillaries are the smallest of the blood vessels. They have the thinnest diameter. And it's here at the capillaries in which materials can exchange between the bloodstream and the tissue cells. Now, all blood vessels are lined by a thin layer of tightly packed epithelial cells. As we'll see as we look at diagrams, there are structural differences in the walls of the different kinds of blood vessels, and these structural differences correlate with their different functions. So here we see arteries, veins, and capillaries. The coloration of these blood vessels lets us know that we're currently looking at the systemic circuit, because it's the systemic circuit in which oxygenated blood is coming from the heart and deoxygenated blood is returning to the heart. If we were looking at the pulmonary circuit, the colors would be switched and the arteries would be blue and the veins would be red. So comparing the walls of the arteries and veins, we can see that these are larger blood vessels, that there are layers of epithelial tissue both outside and inside. There are layers of connective tissue and also smooth muscle. The smooth muscle walls of the arteries are just a bit thicker than those on the veins. However, veins have something that arteries don't, and those are one-way valves, similar to the valves we saw in the heart. Now we'll talk about what those valves are used for in just a moment here. When we look at the capillaries, which are the thinnest of the blood vessels, we see that they're composed primarily of a single layer of epithelium, allowing for the diffusion of oxygen, carbon dioxide, and a variety of other nutrients and waste products to pass right through the walls of that blood vessel. Even though gases and certain materials can pass through the walls of the blood vessels, the red blood cells themselves do not leave the blood vessels, except in cases of injury. As the heart is beating, the force that blood exerts against the walls of your blood vessels is known as your blood pressure. Blood pressure is the main force driving the blood from the heart to the capillary beds. And in fact, our pulse is the rhythmic stretching of our arteries, caused by the pressure of blood forced into the arteries during systole. Remember, systole is the contraction phase of the cardiac cycle. Optimal blood pressure for adult humans is below 120 systolic and below 80 diastolic. Blood pressure is typically given as two measurements, a systolic pressure and a diastolic pressure. And hopefully those sound similar to those stages of the cardiac cycle, systole and diastole. The systolic pressure is always going to be higher because that's the force of the blood on the walls of the arteries right as the heart is beating. The diastolic pressure is the residual pressure on the walls of the arteries, even when the heart is in its relaxing state. Now, high blood pressure is sustained systolic pressure higher than 140 and our diastolic pressure higher than 90. This is also called hypertension. Now, it's important to note that during physical activity, during exercise, during running and the like, It's expected that your blood pressure would go up. Your heart starts beating faster because your muscles need more oxygen. And that's totally normal. It's only when you're resting or relaxing, not doing strenuous activity, and yet your blood pressure still remains elevated, higher than 140 systolic and higher than 90 diastolic, that could be a sign that there may be obstructions or some sort of strain on your cardiovascular system. We have a lot of capillaries. In fact, all of the cells in our body need to be able to get oxygen and nutrients, and so capillaries have to be within diffusion distance of all of them. Since we have so many capillaries, we actually don't have blood flowing through all of them all the time. In fact, at any given time, only about 5 to 10% of your capillaries will have a steady flow of blood flowing through them. I mean, at some point, every capillary will have blood flowing through it, but at any given time, our body is able to control, to some degree, where our blood flows within our body. The walls of capillaries are thin and leaky. As blood enters a capillary at the arterial end, blood pressure pushes fluids that are rich in oxygen, nutrients, and other substances into the interstitial fluid. At the venous end of the capillary, carbon dioxide and other metabolic wastes diffuse from the tissue cells into the capillary's bloodstream. While there is exchange of these nutrients and while there is exchange of fluids, note that the red blood cells do not leave the capillaries. They only do this in case of injury or damage, such as bruising or a cut. So here we see diffusion of oxygen and nutrients out of the blood towards the tissue cells that are performing cellular respiration. Same time, carbon dioxide and waste products by those respiring cells are able to diffuse into the bloodstream. Remember, diffusion happens without any extra energy being required. Diffusion is just a process of the movement of liquids and gases in a solution. After chemicals are exchanged between the blood and body cells, blood returns to the heart via the veins. By the time the blood exits the capillaries and enters the veins, the pressure originating from the heart has dropped to near zero. So all of that force and energy of the heart pumping the blood, it gets the blood to the capillary beds. But how does the blood get back to the heart? We can see here a diagram of the blood pressure. The top line is for the systemic circuit, and the bottom is for the pulmonary circuit. And we can see that fluctuations between the systolic blood pressure and the diastolic blood pressure. But as we move farther down the arteries towards the arterioles and capillaries, we see the blood pressure dropping off. And by the time we get to the venules and the veins, we see there's very low pressure. So how is that blood going to get back to our heart? Blood does still move through the veins against the force of gravity. But it requires two specific mechanisms to do so. First is that these veins are going to be located near skeletal muscles. As those skeletal muscles contract, they will apply pressure on the veins, and that in turn will squeeze that vein, pushing the blood in the vein forward. Now, the reason why the blood is only pushed forward is because veins also have a series of one-way valves to prevent the blood from flowing backwards. So as that region of the vein is compressed, blood moves forward. As that skeletal muscle relaxes, the upper valve will close, and the lower valve will open, and that region of the vein will be refilled with blood. In our next video, we'll talk about the composition of the circulating fluid of the body. We'll talk about what's in the blood. See you in the next video.